There's a lover in the story, but the story's still the same. There's a lullaby for suffering and a paradox to blame. But it's written in the scriptures and it's not some idle claim. You want it darker? We kill the flame. Lining up the prisoners and the guards are taking aim. I struggled with some demons, they were middle class and tame. I didn't know I had permission to murder and to maim. You want it darker?
Slasherholics, this is Sean again. I am here with the 80s slasher librarian, Josh LaRue, and tonight we will be discussing Halloween, The Scream Factory by Kelly O'Rourke. How are you doing today, Josh?
Pretty good. Ready for episode 3, man. And this book is actually part one of a trilogy. All three books are on the channel, and we will be discussing all three books, the other two, later on down the road here on Out of Print Slashers.
See, it was cool because when I started listening to your channel, I started out with the third one, which was The Madhouse, I believe.
Yes.
And it's kind of interesting. If you pair all of the covers of these books, the first one, Scream Factory, the second one, Old Myers Place, the third one, The Madhouse, they kind of look like Nancy Drew ran into Michael Myers with a knife.
Yes.
That's kind of how each of these look, just the artwork.
Well, they are young adult novels, so... But funny story before we actually discuss the book, I kind of put my foot in my mouth when it came to these books in the beginning, because when I first started the channel, I knew that the Jason and Freddy books were expensive, you know, cause I'd already bought most of them. And, someone's like, you should do the young adult Jason books. I was like, I'm going to do those Eric Morse books. Yes, I will. Somebody else is like, you ought to do those young adult Halloween novels from the 90s, Kelly O'Rourke wrote them. And I was like, I will. I'll do those. I promise you. And then a couple months went by, and I went to look them up. I was like, I'll go buy them. I got a little extra money. Yeah, man, those books were like $125, $150 bucks a piece.
Yeah, but they're good. And I don't know. It's like they're 200 pages a piece, but to me, they accomplished what they needed to do. I mean, you got some character development, you got some slasher, a little bit of gore, wasn't too incredibly graphic, and to me, it kind of accomplished what some of the Halloween movies didn't. I mean, you have teenagers doing their thing, and they run into Michael, but some of the movies tried to go into cults, and they brought astrology into it. At a certain point, it just didn't feel like Halloween anymore, but
yeah,
it kind of goes back to its roots.
Yeah, we're just going to talk about the first one tonight, but yeah, this one definitely felt like it was the roots of Halloween. He finds somebody, he stalks them, kills anybody that gets in his path, you know, and it's the unknown factor that makes Michael so scary, and the book really does handle that. And surprisingly, for a middle school / high school age group audience for the book, that's who the book was written for, surprisingly, the gore it does have, the sex it does have, the language it does have is surprising. But then again, that was the 90s, and we had all the cool shit back then. But,
I mean, a lot of the gore was left a lot to your imagination. I think they said one guy looked like he was thrown from the Empire State Building. I mean, I don't know what Michael could have done to that guy. I mean, I know, but...
Is that the cop that got his face stomped in?
Yeah, that's an image right there.
Yeah, I know. You're just sitting there... sitting there in eighth grade picturing that in your head, you know? And they probably sold these at the book fair, you know?
I think that actually did happen to Dr. Sartain in the 2018 version, the newest Halloween got his face stomped in.
Well, let's dive into the book, man. Our protagonist for the story, our main one, is Lori. Her name is actually Lori. That threw me for a loop when I first started reading. I was like, is this Lori? But no, it's a different Lori.
You gotta think of all the names they could have picked. They went with Lori. That's kind of strange.
And we do need to set this up. The book takes place 15 years after the events of Halloween, part one. That's what the book says, anyways.
Onto that. They said chronologically, this book is supposed to happen after the novelization of Halloween 4. So somewhere between, 15 years after the fourth one. It's kind of vague on those details.
They keep mentioning 15 years ago, such and such happened in the book. So that's what I was going by.
Yeah, when they're looking through those files.
Yeah, you know, like 15 years ago, this guy killed these people. And it's interesting that when the book begins, Michael is kind of like an urban legend. It's like kind of what the townsfolk in Springwood did with Freddy. They kind of made him like a made-up boogeyman. You know, even though the stuff really happened, over time they've tried to convince people to forget it, act like it never happened. And now, years later, it's to the point that a lot of people don't believe that Michael Myers really existed. Some of the characters in this book didn't believe he existed till they saw him. And I thought that was kind of interesting that in this continuation or whatever, that these people don't even think he's real. But yeah, it does state the events happened.
There was a maniac in a black jumpsuit that killed people 15 years ago in a nondescript white plastic mask.
Right. And it's like just the story they tell kids to, you know, scare them, and the kids think it's made up, you know. Okay. You know, going into this book, it is a young adult novel, and I wasn't expecting a lot out of it because of that. But it was really good. I mean, from the very beginning, you can tell these characters are your stereotypical teenagers. You know, maybe even toned down a little bit from the movies. You think I should do a quick clip here introducing them to a couple of the main characters of the story?
Absolutely.
Let's do that. Let's let you meet Lori and her friends.
Lori swept her long blonde hair over the back of her pale pink sweater. Sally Wilson passed a note to Lori, who sat at the desk directly behind her. Carefully, Lori opened the folded piece of paper in her lap and noticed that the note was a bit damp. She let out a little giggle as she read. I'm so bored. I just noticed that I was drooling on this very piece of paper. Lori turned around and whispered, You are so gross. Mrs. Grubbs gave the girls both a warning, then turned her attention to the whole class. Okay, seniors, she said. As I told you before, this class is a tough course in American history. I want to make sure that you're prepared for the real world next year. Get out your notebooks and write down the following practical assignment. The whole class groaned in unison. Waving her arms to quiet the class, Mrs. Grubbs continued, This assignment, I'm hoping, will be fun. You're going to pair up in teams and research a historical event. The subject is your choice. Your reports will be due this Friday and must be at least 5 pages long, so be creative and have fun. More groans and sighs came from the class as Mrs. Grubbs answered scattered questions about the assignment. Lori turned around to face Sally. Want to be a team with me? Sally smirked. Of course, dummy. We've only been best Jeep friends for 5 years, and this happens to be our only class together this semester. She tore a sheet of paper from her notebook and pushed it to Lori. She joked, But you'll need to sign here and here and here to make this partnership official. Lori felt a slight blush spread across her freckled cheeks. True, Sally was her best friend, but sometimes her sarcasm was a little annoying. The two friends were a contrast. Lori, with her girl-next-door looks and almost shy personality, and Sally, the dark-haired tigress with flawless skin and a more than occasional flash of mischief in her bright green eyes. A loud sigh filled the classroom. The girls whirled around to see Marcia Miller, the snobby and rich heir to Haddonfield's biggest company, Miller Realty. Marcia stood up at her desk as she smoothed her designer dress, which she wore with her poutiest expression. She ran her fingers through her sleekly styled hair, whining, Like, But Mrs. Grubbs, certainly you must know about my big Halloween party this weekend. How can I possibly be expected to complete this history assignment while planning the biggest social event in town? The girls giggled as Mrs. Grubbs rolled her eyes. I'm sure you'll find a way, Marcia, she said. Marcia stamped her foot as she slumped into her seat. She shot her meanest look at Sally, who was smirking at her little temper tantrum.
So, Halloween, the Scream Factory. The plot in a nutshell is basically Lori and her friend Sally kind of get tasked by the mayor to come up with a haunted house to try to get teenagers off the streets, have them in one safe location. So they turn City Hall into a place they call the Scream Factory. It's going to be the big party that everyone goes to, which is going to rival the nemesis, Marcia, the rich girl's party. Because
the frenemy.
There's a little bit of rivalry right there.
And enter your cliche bad boy Jake. Leather jacket and all. Marcia and Lori fighting over him. Marcia's throwing a party. You got Lori having the Scream Factory party at City Hall. They're trying to get Jake to have his band play. That's one of the subplots, is them pretty much fighting over this guy.
Yeah, that might actually be him on the front cover, and the leather jacket looks like Fonzie, but Fonzie and Auntie Drew running from Michael Myers.
I did like his character, though. Like, I thought it was just going to be, freaking cliche. But he was actually a pretty cool character.
Well, there's a little bit of mystique with him, because he actually knew the Myers house and has been to the Myers house. So you're thinking, is Michael really back? Is it this weird guy, Jake, who's kind of a loner, but he has a band? What's up with him?
Yep. And, you know, early on in the book, one thing I do love about the book is the little sections that are given to Michael whenever he's stalking. I don't know if you enjoyed that part, those parts, but I did. Because there's plenty of little segments of the book where it's from Michael's point of view. And he finds these kids and he starts watching them. And Lori becomes pretty much his object of obsession. Use a little Dead by Daylight term there.
Yeah, and I know a lot of people didn't like his growling, but, I mean, if he's going to make any noise, I would rather it be a growl than him screaming, die, and hitting someone. You know, like, growling's kind of animalistic. I'll take it.
You know, that's the whole die thing. I'll let that go because, like, I see those two Halloween movies as, like, Rob Zombie's vision for Halloween, and I separate that from actual Halloween. And as far as his vision goes, all the power to him. It was his movie. It's kind of cool in a way, but it's not Michael. It's not Halloween.
Yeah, it was the first Halloween I saw in theaters. It'll always have a special place.
Oh man, I'm sorry.
But
I mean, I didn't hate the movie. I didn't hate him yelling "die." You know, I just thought that was all the frustration from all those years just built up. But as far as this Michael goes, this Michael in the book is supposed to be the Michael we saw in the original Halloween movies. And yeah, the growling threw me off a little bit, but the way I sold it to myself was thinking maybe he's not like going, rawr, 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 you know, maybe it's just like, cause it makes it sound like he's like growling like a dog or something, but maybe it's just like the noises you would make it do an exertion. You know what I mean? Like stabbing. Maybe it's that, I don't know, but it's not like he's standing around growling and slobbering on himself. I think that was just people nitpicking, to be honest with you.
Yeah, but it didn't bother me that much. I mean, you wasn't talking.
What bothered me the most was the black jumpsuit.
Yeah,
but I got past that too. So yeah, they get with the mayor and they're going to set up this Scream Factory. They're going to have a party there, and they want it to be the the main party of the night, put Marcia to shame, and they get to meet up with the mayor, and they start going through some city files. I don't want to give too much away. And see, these characters, some of them don't think that Michael really existed. And they come across some files, and that's a pretty interesting part of the book. The realization that this guy was real and he could still be out there. And unbeknownst to them, he's already stalking Lori. So, And as we get closer to Halloween night, I thought it was a pretty cool scene when Jake and Lori are on his motorcycle. I think you know the scene I'm talking about here.
Absolutely.
And Michael has pretty much laid a trap. He has cut a tree down in the road. And Jake and Lori call it in to the police. And when the police go to check it out, there's a really, really cool confrontation with Michael Myers between this officer checking out the downed tree in the road and what I would say is one of Michael's most brutal kills of the book. And I think we should give it away just to show people how cool this book actually is. Go ahead and play a clip of this police officer meeting Michael at the trap that Michael laid. You think that's giving too much away?
No, I think it's good.
Let's do it.
A squad car with its blue and red lights flashing was pulled over to the side of the road. A bright flashlight shone into Lori's eyes as she passed. The huge tree that had almost killed them earlier had been moved to the side of the road. Officer Baker bit into his raspberry-filled jelly donut, an award which he felt he deserved after being assigned to remove the giant tree from the road. Sometime, the department chief still treated him like a rookie, even though he'd been on the police force for nearly 5 years now. He watched the blue sedan disappear down the road and carefully pulled his swimsuit edition magazine out from under his seat. He'd wait a few minutes before he reported back into the station, he decided. Baker opened the worn pages to his favorite centerfold and closed his eyes. He imagined that he was lying on the beach with the exotic beauty on the magazine page. He could almost feel the warmth of the sandy beach. Officer Baker jumped up and hit his head against the ceiling as something plowed into the side of his patrol car, causing the black and white to jolt. He threw the magazine into the back seat and shouted, "What the?" Before he could finish his sentence, a hulking figure appeared next to his window and grabbed at the door handle. Baker screamed in shock as his scorching 32-ounce coffee spilled across his lap. "What the hell are you doing?" he yelled. As Baker grabbed for his shotgun, the figure peered inside the window. His hot breath made a round patch of fog on the outside of the window. Baker saw the shaped space as the flashing siren lights pulsated through the darkness. Instinctively, he clutched the shotgun, struggling to get it out of the dashboard frame. His mouth hung open, and he began babbling when he realized what was happening. The figure wore a tattered, dark, navy blue jumpsuit and had his face hidden behind a white plastic mask. Baker knew who or what he was dealing with. He remembered the stories he heard about Michael Myers. Before the officer could pull the safety off the shotgun and fire, Michael Myers had jarred open the door and grabbed Baker's arm. Baker screamed as his body was wrenched from the car and thrown into the gravel. Michael Myers had him. Baker's screams were cut short when Michael Myers stomped on his face with a worn steel-toed work boot. Excruciating pain shot through the officer's head as his skull cracked like a watermelon that had been dropped off the Empire State Building. His legs twitched and his brain felt as if it had short-circuited as the sticky, warm blood flowed out of his mouth and ears. Michael Myers dragged the limp body of the officer into the dark clearing and pulled an axe from beneath a pile of brush.
Yeah, I like this book as a whole. I really like how it ended with the party going on and Michael going at it, because I mean we haven't really had that in the movies. He kind of stalks person by person. Occasionally there's like a room full of a couple people, but I don't think he ever crashed a Halloween party. Not like he did in this book.
Yeah, it was kind of like Jason crashing the party in Freddy versus Jason, but it's, you know, you never seen Michael in that type of scenario.
Michael's a little more calculating.
There were some creepy scenes, man. Even though some of them were bait and switch, when they're just setting up the Scream Factory, you know, sometimes you think that Michael's already there, ends up being something else. But there are some creepy scenes in this book. Very suspenseful, makes it feel just like the original movie. For instance, when Matt and Sally go out to his Jeep in a parking lot and it's been vandalized. I don't want to give too much away because that subplot's actually pretty interesting with Marcia and everything. Jake, or I'm sorry, Matt and Sally get in an argument, and Matt goes off on his own and ends up driving by the Myers place and sees the chief of police's vehicle there. And he thinks it's a good time to file a police report on the vandalized vehicle. You remember that scene?
Yeah, I liked it because Michael knew how to hit trigger points with people to get them to make really dumb decisions, and then he would get them. So it's almost just, it's almost like he was setting up the games, watching them play out, and then stepping in at certain moments. And that's the kind of Michael we got from the original and the preceding sequels.
I thought it was cool that he was staying at his house, you know, that when he came back to town, that he was literally staying in his old house. And so many characters go in this house during the book, and every time you're expecting them to die, you know?
Well, see, that can be a callback to the original, because Loomis, that's the first place he went to, and he was waiting for hours, like, in the bushes, just waiting and waiting, while Michael was killing at different houses, and then he left the house, because he was sure that Michael would be there, because he did come home, because he killed that dog.
Yep. And Michael being at that house, man, I gotta say, the author, the way she wrote a lot of these scenes, she was really good at making it very visual. You could really just play it out. I love authors to do that. Jeffrey Thomas did that with The Dream Dealers. And just having a scene with, like, one of the characters at the front door of the Myers house and the porch, the wood is so rotten it breaks out beneath them. The way she wrote that scene, now it made it just as suspenseful as if Michael was chasing a character. It's hard to explain, but I really think people really enjoy this book. And that's what I was wanting to set up with the Myers house. You do get a lot of bait and switch there, too, but you do get some real Michael Myers scene with characters there. And there's that scene where Matt sees the chief of police's car there, and he's going to go file a police report because his Jeep had been vandalized. And he's walking around the house, and the chief is upstairs, and the chief calls down to him, "What are you doing down there?" You know, and he's like, "I need to file a police report." And the chief's like, "Okay, I'll be down in a minute." And it's so suspenseful because it talks about how Matt's just sitting there waiting and waiting for the chief, and the chief never comes down. And then Matt decides to go in the house. And as a reader, I'm like, "You idiot. What are you? This is exactly the reason you don't go in the house." You know, but he goes. Did you catch yourself doing that at all in the book, saying, "What, really?" You know?
Yeah, there are a couple of times where a character would make a questionable decision or a rush decision, but, I mean, it's to be expected with tensions being that high. I mean, his Jeep got vandalized. He's not going to be making a lot of smart decisions because that's all he's thinking about.
Yeah,
all
that's a good
relationship.
Point. And he's one of the guys that really doesn't even believe Michael's around, you know?
Yeah.
And, but I think the scene plays out really suspenseful when he goes in to see the chief, to find the chief in the house. And we get one of our first scenes in the book with Michael interacting with one of our main characters, and gets pretty brutal and pretty graphic in this scene. And that's one of the ones I had on my notes here that I wanted to play a clip of, because that whole scene with the chief and Matt and Michael is pretty damn suspenseful. Check it out, guys. Give it a listen here.
Matt slowed as he passed the old Myers house. A police car was parked outside with the windows rolled down. The rotting old house cast an eerie shadow across the weeded yard in the early moonlight. What was going on in there, he wondered, pulling to the side of the road. Maybe the officer inside would take a vandalism report on his car. Matt hesitated before getting out. The house seemed to be warning him to stay away. He shook his head in an attempt to clear his mind. He threw on an oversized denim shirt and followed the path of broken stepping stones around back. "Hello?" he called, walking through the side yard. There was no answer. Matt approached the back door, which was sealed off with banners of yellow police tape. "Police barrier, do not cross." "Weird," he whispered, as goosebumps popped up on his skin. "I'm out of here," he said to himself. The house was giving him the creeps. Matt had never listened to the stories the kids told. He believed in checking things out for himself, and so far, he'd seen nothing to make him believe in ghosts and ghouls and the boogeyman. Just some stupid, creepy pranks. That's why the police were here, he rationalized. Matt's sneakers crunched in the dirt as he started back around the side of the house. The officer could be anywhere, in the woods or even next door. Hey! Matt jumped at the sound of a voice that snapped like a whip crack. He looked up and saw Chief Grandy staring down at him from the second-story window. What in tarnation are you doing here, boy? He demanded, eyeing the teenager with suspicion. Matt caught his breath, his heart pumping furiously. I just saw your car parked out here and wanted to see if you could take a vandalism report real quick. Someone trashed my car today. It's sitting out front, Matt said. Grandy sighed. Your car, huh? Okay, son, I'll be right down. Take a look. Anxious to get away from the house, Matt went and leaned against the Jeep. Minutes passed. What is he doing in there? Matt wondered, looking at his watch impatiently. Sally's really going to be steamed if I'm late, he thought. Matt called out, Chief, are you coming out? The wind picked up, whispering through the forest. Matt's feet led him back to the front porch. He carefully stepped around the caved-in boards and pushed the front door open. A wave of musty, mildewed air made him cough. He stepped inside the eerily dark house. He wasn't too afraid, though, with the police chief inside, somewhere. Chief, he called. I've got to go, man. I'm running late, he said, his voice seeming to disappear into the peeling wallpaper. Matt gripped the railing of the staircase and carefully felt his way up by touch. The staircase groaned as he reached the top. Hello? He said softly, as not to startle the chief. After all, the man did carry a gun and probably didn't like being sneaked up on. Aha! There you are, Matt said with a sigh, spotting a light down the hall in the front bedroom. He followed the light through the darkness and reached for the doorknob. He pushed the door open. Chief, I've really got to go, sir. I'm late for a party and... Matt froze in shock. Through the dim, flickering light of a jack-o'-lantern, the crumpled body of Police Chief Grandy became visible, lying in a pool of fresh blood that pumped silently around the butcher knife embedded in his heart. Matt tried to drown out the horrible sound of his own screaming. His knees became weak, and his brain was unable to believe what his eyes were seeing. The badge on the chief's chest flashed in the jagged flashes of light. He was dead. His glassy eyes stared lifelessly in the orange glow from the jack-o'-lantern. Oh, God, this isn't really happening! Suddenly, Matt heard a noise, a faint stomping sound, footsteps. His glint of hope that it might be help instantly turned to terror as he realized that the sound was moving up the stairs. Someone was in the house. Matt's heart stopped. He could barely breathe or move his muscles. He forced himself to take a step. Instinctively, he pried the bloody knife out of Grandy's chest, and it slid out with the sound of a sickening crunch of bones. The footsteps moved slowly and heavily toward the room. Matt was trapped. He could hear the killer breathing in the darkness. Matt struggled to stay conscious. His head was spinning and his heart pounded painfully in his chest. This can't be happening. The dark shape now stood in the doorway. Matt could feel his cold, rancid breath as he growled softly. The figure stepped into the flickering light. His entire horrifying body, covered in a muddy and bloody navy blue jumpsuit, was visible. Matt let out a deafening scream. It was Michael Myers. Matt's arm froze as he tried to raise the knife, horrified by the black, dead eyes watching him from behind the white plastic mask beneath a tangle of matted, wiry hair. The hideous monster raised his arms and lunged forward. Matt jumped backward toward the bedroom window. Michael Myers lunged again, coming closer and closer. I'm going to die, Matt kept thinking. Using all of his energy, Matt drove the knife through the eye hole in the mask. A dark stream of blood trickled down the white plastic as Michael Myers stumbled backward. Matt struggled to pry open the window. Michael Myers pulled the knife out of his eye and began slashing at the air, moving closer to Matt. Matt jammed the window open and looked down at the concrete below. It was his only chance. He dove out the window, landing with a crash on a pile of boards below. Stars shone in his closed eyes for a moment as excruciating pain set in his ankle. He screamed out for help, but there was no one around. Matt forced himself to get up. He had to get help. If he could only make it to the Jeep. He winced with every painful step. The Jeep was still there, thank God. But what was the hood doing up? I don't remember. Terror filled his brain as he stared at the handle of an axe driven through his engine. A tangle of ripped wires and hoses sprouted out from under the hood. Never had he been so alone and helpless and terrified. Run, Matt, run, he told himself. Through the woods. Gotta get back to town. Go. Forget about the pain. Just run. Matt stumbled across the street into the black forest. The woods were the fastest way back. Only a mile. If he could just make it back into town. He had to make it. Had to warn the others. Had to get away from Michael Myers.
So yeah, you see what we're talking about with the pretty brutal and pretty graphic for a young adult novel, wouldn't you say, Sean?
Oh yeah. That's what I liked about her writing. I mean, it just goes to show that, you know, you don't need 400 pages to tell a good story. Each of these are about, what, 200 pages. They're visual, they're interesting. You go in depth with certain characters, and not only that, like with William Pattison's Jason books, these are sequential. They come one after another one, or one after the other one, Scream Factory, Old Myers Place, Madhouse. Mm-hmm. And there's continuity that we don't get with a lot of the other books, with Freddy mm-hmm. and Jason, how it's each one is its own kind of continuity. Just
you
another
can put it anywhere. Yeah.
Yeah, just another thumbs up for Kelly O'Rourke. Really like that.
Yeah, because that scene really puts you in Matt's head and the fear he's feeling. You know, it is kind of cool in that scene that he gets to fight back a little bit against Michael, even draw some blood. I enjoyed that. There's a lot of jack-o'-lanterns in this book, though. A lot of jack-o'-lanterns that are going to pop up a lot, just so you know.
A couple confused me. Like, there were just messages written on them that I wasn't sure what the hell Michael was talking about, or if Michael even did it.
Exactly.
It kind of leaves it up in the air. Like, is Michael leaving these? Is Marsha leaving these pumpkins? Why... There's revenge written on it. Who's revenge against who? I don't know.
I know, and there's like that little sub-story of the mayor knowing Lori's dad at some point and stuff, and that doesn't really go anywhere. But
one of them is like a poem about her death, and I'm like, did Michael write a poem?
Exactly. You know, is it somebody just using the legend of Michael to scare her, or they never? It doesn't really get cleared up. But man, as far as plot holes go, there's not many in this book. It's not enough to throw you off. If anything, the second book in the series, I'm going to have more complaints about, and you know why. You wrote the fanfic epilogue for me to help me get over that.
Oh yeah, I had to do that.
But we'll talk about that one when we cover the Old Myers Place. But the book does not drag on too long. Of course, you got to set up the character, set up the story. But once things get to Halloween day and Halloween night, especially after the scene that we just played with Matt fleeing, trying to warn people about Michael, things from here on out in the book until the end are just, it's like a roller coaster ride because it's the night of the party.
I would think it would be like, it's like it was slasher up until the end, then it kind of became Final Destination.
Yeah. I do like the bait and switch that gets done when all the lights go out the first time at the party, and everybody's freaking out. But then you find out that Jake made his decision about which party he was going to have his band play out. But because when I was first reading that, I was like, "Wow!" You know, I was on the edge of my seat. What's going to happen? And then that was a pretty cool little surprise. But it really gets interesting because this Marsha girl is like a frenemy, and she decides to play a prank, and it's like the kid who cried wolf, you know, because then later the real deal shows up, and one of the characters is like, "You're not going to trick me again, Marsha," and it's like, "You're right," because it's not Marsha. But what leads to the conclusion of the book is what I wanted to talk about with you, Sean. They all end up barricaded in this building at some point. We don't want to give that away, of course, how it happens. But that really sets the suspense and the scenes up for the finale. Because not only are they barricaded in, but a fire starts out. Starts up in the building.
Yeah, that definitely added scale to the book. As far as like some of the movies were, I think the first one took place in a couple different houses. The second one was a hospital. I mean, this one is a party at City Hall where things get locked in, and just it's a bigger scale than we've seen before. So it allowed a lot of different things to play out, different kills, different creativity. I don't know. It was just really epic for a 200-page book. I was really surprised reading it.
Yeah, because I mean the stakes are so high there at the end, man. Whenever they're in this building, they know that Michael is real. They know that Michael is killed. It's people they know. Michael has barricaded them in this building, and not only do they have to avoid being killed by him, but they also got to figure out a way to escape this fire. I mean, the way she sets the whole thing up is just really gets you into the story. You know, you don't want to see these people die, but you can feel their fear, because you're like in this damned if you do, damned if you don't situation. You know, it's like either Michael's going to get me or I'm going to burn to death. You know, it's there's not a lot of hope. She really set that hopeless vibe there, which we're not going to, you know, give away the ending or anything, but it has a pretty good payoff. There's one little bait and switch that happens towards the end that I thought was a bit cheesy, but all in all, man, the way it plays out is pretty badass, actually.
Yeah, I don't really think I had any complaints about this book. One of mine, it was just really, really minor because I pay attention to details. I know we're supposed to know what Michael looks like, but I feel like I could have done a little bit more with his description other than a big man in a white mask. That is incredibly vague. It could have been like, it looked like a human face, it looked like Shatner, something, just a big man right. in a plastic yeah. white mask. Like, that could be anything.
And they do talk about his breath a lot, too, you know? Because you know his breath has to stink. And, the author definitely brings up his stinky breath a few times.
A big growling man with bad breath and a black jumpsuit.
Halitosis.
White mask.
Halitosis 4, The Return of Michael Myers.
That's weird some of the descriptions we got in the other hallway novelizations. I'm not going into that right now, but you know what I mean.
Yes, I cannot wait to discuss the first Halloween novelization. That one's going to be interesting. The last clip I was going to play, before we have our discussion overall, is probably when the fire breaks out at City Hall at the Scream Factory. I don't want to give too much away in the clip, but I just kind of want to show y'all how she sets the dread up here and, just puts you into that situation with the characters, and it's very suspenseful. So, here's the last clip, guys. Give it a listen.
Way down the stairs and through the maze. The screaming was coming from the dance floor. He stood on top of a filing cabinet and shone his flashlight through the room, where he saw a dark shape drop down from the basement window. A wave of masked faces rushed from the far wall toward the maze, knocking down the filing cabinets like a row of dominoes. Jake was thrown off balance. He landed painfully on the cement floor. The sound of screeching metal mixed with screams filled the room. Jake kicked the thin metal box hard with his boots, and climbed out from underneath a warped, empty filing cabinet. Carefully, he climbed over the mess and made his way toward the dance floor. The scene reminded him of a riot he'd been stuck in at a rock concert last summer. Panicked bodies flew from one side of the room to the other, pressing together with the force of crashing waves. Jake was terrified of what he might find as he reached the nearly deserted dance floor. He shone his flashlight across the crying, masked faces. He knew what he was looking for, the horrible face of Michael Myers. Suddenly, the giant spider web across the ceiling came crashing down on top of him and 50 other people. Hundreds of black and white balloons filled the air. Screams rose up as the kids struggled to release themselves from the giant tangle of woven rope. Their bodies were pinned against the ground and their struggling only tangled them worse. Jake swung his flashlight around in an attempt to see the end of the giant web. Maybe he could somehow pull it off and break free. Horror stabbed through his entire body as he shone the beam of light across the stage. Inside the storage cage were his three band members, their bodies hanging lifelessly, their necks sticking out at sickening crooked angles. Blood dripped to the stage floor, and their eyes were glassy and cold and dead as their broken bodies swung. Jake screamed out, "No!" He fell to his knees. Complete suffocation of hopelessness and defeat was washing over him. Jake forced himself to look away from the stage. Every bouncing white balloon looked like the face of Michael Myers. Fear struck through Jake's heart as the balloons all seemed to blur together. A new breed of fear had entered his mind, one he was sure he'd never forget, if he lived through this night. Lori stumbled across the wreckage of the basement, searching for Jake. She was able to make out the white outline of the spiderweb that lay on the ground. The trapped bodies seemed helpless, like tiny flies. "Jake!" she screamed. Her voice was drowned out by cries of pain and cries of terror. Chapter 29. Upstairs, Matt and Sally were pressed tightly against the wall. People were pounding on the glass doors, trying to jar them open, despite Matt's protests. Suddenly, the horribly disfigured Michael Myers lurched up the stairs into the eerie, dark shadows of the lobby. Sally was slammed against the wall by a force of scattering bodies, desperately trying to move back. Hysteria swept through the room. There was no one there to save them. Michael stood at the top of the staircase, holding a rusted gasoline can in one hand and a burning jack-o'-lantern in the other. Hell had arrived. Michael had come home. Shrieks of terror swept across the floor as he emptied the can of flammable liquid across the walls and drapery. Choking gasoline fumes filled the room. Matt screamed, "Jump him!" No one moved. They were all helplessly frozen. Matt looked at the gleaming pumpkins that sat on the floor. Gasoline dripped off the walls dangerously close to the flames. As if in slow motion, Matt felt his body moving across the room. He was blinded by terror and rage, but he kept moving closer and closer. Michael Myers stepped forward toward him and clasped his huge hands around Matt's throat. Matt gasped and struggled with all his strength and pushed the two of them backwards down the stairs. They tumbled into the darkness. A jack-o'-lantern flung against the wall, igniting a gasoline-soaked curtain. The lobby lit up in an orange blaze. Terrified people shrieked for help as they clawed and beat at the windows and walls. Without thinking about the consequence of her actions, Sally fought her way through the crowd and the smoke and went tearing down into the basement after Matt. In minutes, she thought the whole place would go up in flames. She found Matt lying on top of a twisted filing cabinet. The flames from upstairs cast a horrifying light across the basement. Sally could see a few struggling bodies, still tangled in the web, and the balloons bobbing through the room. She looked at Matt and then back at the kids trapped on the dance floor. There wasn't time to help them now, she decided. She pulled Matt to his feet and glanced around the room. Her body was numb with fright. Michael Myers was nowhere to be seen. He disappeared into the maze. "Come on!" Sally screamed. They felt their way along the back walls of the building around the dance floor. The smoke was growing thicker, and the fire was spreading quickly. Matt hoisted...
So let's discuss final thoughts of Halloween the Scream Factory.
Yeah, I thought it was a really great book overall. Didn't really know what to expect going into a Michael Myers book, but it paid off way better than I thought. I mean, you wouldn't think someone like Jason and Freddy and Michael would do great in the books, but honestly, I was happy. I would have been happy if that replaced one of the sequels for Halloween, and I'm pretty sure you know which ones I'm talking about there as well.
Yeah. And you know, we only have three original Michael Myers novels. The you know, Freddy and Jason have a ton, but Michael has three, and it's this trilogy.
Yeah, I mean, they could have done a lot more with him, but it's interesting how there's three books. They're split into Scream Factory, which is kind of like City Hall, the mayor, that side of it. Mm-hmm. Myers Place, which is his house, and Madhouse, which is Smith's Grove Sanitarium. So it really goes into the three locations Michael is big at. The heart of Haddonfield, his house, and the asylum. I'm not really sure where else they would go, but they put Jason in the damn jungle. So they right? could have done anything with Michael. But
and hell. They put him in hell.
Yeah.
And on some moons.
One thing that they could have done with Michael that's interesting, there's this fan, they make fan films. It's a channel called Blinky 500, and they do a kind of like Freddy vs. Jason 2, where Freddy's trying to look for someone else to get him back to the world, and he tries to tap Michael in hell. When he visits Michael, Michael is in almost like a room in the sanitarium, and it's dark, and he's sitting at a metal chair and a metal table, and the only light in the room is a jack-o'-lantern that's lit, and he's staring into his eyes, and he goes, excuse me?
Well, there's a fanfic I heard about, called a fan book called The Trial of Michael Myers.
Yeah.
And I've wanted to give that a read, you know, because that sounds interesting. Sounds like something that might be fun to read. Have you heard of that one, The Trial of Michael Myers?
I haven't.
You can actually buy it on Amazon. I'm not sure how they're able to sell it since it's not a officially licensed book, but it's there. It's called The Trial of Michael Myers. I want to check that one out. If anybody listening has read that book, let us know in the comment section if that's a book worth checking out. I'd love to know. But as far as the Scream Factory goes, and sticking to the lore of Michael Myers, respecting the intellectual property of Michael Myers and all that, I think Kelly O'Rourke did. I think she took enough creative liberties to satisfy her own, creative influence on the book, you know, what she wanted to do. Because when you work with these intellectual properties, you know, you gotta toe the line with the story. And she didn't go too far off the mark at any point enough to be like, yeah, it's not Michael. In fact, she was very respectful to the history of the Halloween movies and Michael. And it really did feel like it was the same Michael Myers that I saw in the movies. And that's something I really respect about this book and its sequels. Other than the growling and the black jumpsuit thing. And as you said, the nondescript white mask. But I thought she respected Michael pretty well. You know, I really enjoyed it. Can't really make a list of things I didn't like about it, because there's really not much I didn't like about this book. The second one I have some complaints about, but the first one I thought was pretty solid all around. And if you're a Michael Myers fan, you owe it to yourself to either find copies of the book or head over to the channel and listen to my audiobook versions. Do you think she handled Michael pretty good overall?
Yeah, didn't really have any complaints about that either. Because in other Michael books, they try to go into Michael's head, and some of the books, I don't agree with what they think Michael is thinking about some of these people. But in this one, you really didn't go into much. You went into how he feels, but not what he thinks. Because I think it was the novelization where he just kept thinking every woman was really hot and just getting just really excited by it. That was just really weird.
Now, laughing in this book was a big thing that set him off. That seemed to upset him more than anything. Because it always zeroed in on people laughing. Whenever you were in his POV, it would be like Michael heard them laughing, their laughter, you know, and that seemed to enrage him. I think that's going back to when he was a kid, maybe people making fun of him or something, or what did you take from that?
It's kind of hard to say. I mean, it's kind of hard to pinpoint what sets Michael off. I mean, with Jason, you enter the camp, you made him angry, you die. With Michael, you never 100% know why he kills certain people.
That's what I love about it. I was just saying, like, in this book particular, the author keeps bringing up how Michael gets enraged by the people laughing. Like, he can't stand hearing these teens laughing. Like, for some reason, that keeps getting brought up in the Scream Factory. You know, that's a thing that keeps getting repeated.
Having a lot more fun than he is, I guess.
I guess, you know, but it seems to piss him off. One of the things that sets him off. But I think I think everybody listening, if you haven't heard the book already, I think you'll enjoy it. Don't let the whole young adult novel thing throw you off, because really, other than a few subplots with teenagers, which, hey, that's what the first Halloween movie was like anyways, teenagers. It really feels like a Michael Myers, something you would see on the big screen. It really does, and I don't think you're going to be disappointed. I don't know what else to I can really say. You know, it's a great
yeah,
read, great listen.
I think they might have lost a lot of people at the young adult. That's like when you hear a horror movie coming out of PG-13, you immediately lose a quarter of your audience because they assume that the movie is going to be tamer. But this didn't feel like a young adult novel. It just felt like shorter than the other novels. That's it.
Yeah, I mean, sure. You know, I can't even say it was super toned down, because there's a couple deaths in this book that are more graphic than some of the Friday the 13th Black Flame novels. There's sex in this book. It talks about sex. There's cussing. There's at least one or two F-bombs I know of. So yeah, don't let the whole young adult novel thing throw you off. Give it a try. If you're a Michael Myers fan, hey, there's only three original novels that are official novels that have ever been written about Michael, and that's the Kelly O'Rourke trilogy. So at the very least, you owe it to yourself, if you're a Michael Myers fan, to at least experience these books. Would you agree?
Oh, yeah.
All right, man. I think we've discussed this one about as much as we can. I don't want to give too much more away about the story. You know, we've already given away a lot, but I want you guys listening to be able to enjoy it and see it play out, or hear it play out yourselves. Yeah, so I think that just about does it for Halloween the Scream Factory.
Okay, so yeah, that you're right. That just about wraps up episode 3, Halloween the Scream Factory. Tagline on the front cover: Michael Myers is up to his old tricks, and it will be a treat.
I want to thank our patrons. If it wasn't for you guys, we wouldn't be here doing the podcast, and the channel wouldn't still be pumping out new out-of-print slasher audiobook narrations. Patrons I want to say thank you to, the ones we have currently, are Bonanza Jellybean, Bree, Carl Eakins, Cecilia Spears, Allison Saib, Hawaii, Iron Alexa, Catherine McClear, Kyantez, Ryan Woodward, TikTok 12, and Sean Campbell. Thank you, Sean. So yeah, guys, thank you so much for listening. I'm looking forward to episode 4. I think we're going to be discussing Friday the 13th, Hell Lake. Sound all right to you? I've been looking forward to this one, man.
That's going to be fun.
Until then, this has been your friendly neighborhood 80 slasher librarian saying, thanks for listening. You can't keep a good guy down. And pleasant dreams!
This is Sean Campbell, and in the famous words of Michael Myers...